professional artist. Beautiful. I'm going to ask you guys, just because every once in a while my internet connection jumps out, if that happens, I will be back on. So please just remain patient, stay there. And when I do, if that happens and I get back in, just remind me to hit the record button again, please. that way I can splice them together and you can get the full presentation, all right? And I'm going to actually write myself a note. I'm obsessed with sticky notes. Record. I will put that right there on my monitor just in case anything happens. Okay. All right. Excellent. Teresa, I'm going to totally mess up your name here. Page. I apologize. I'm going to unmute you. Could you tell me your name? Can you pronounce it for me? P-E-J-J? P-J, right? P-J-J? Okay. I do like the way it looks when it's written. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. Enough of you guys are on here. Other people will probably be coming in. Lewis has been here before. He's a member at the Academy of Composition, which actually we started almost a year ago, which is probably a little bit more than a year ago. I'm Don Victor, and I'm going to go ahead and just get started in this presentation. Let me do this. I do want that. Let me figure something out here. Okay. So I'm going to put this chat box over in the corner here. This is going to be here. And I'm going to unmute everyone. Mute everyone. Okay, phone is off. All right. So the lecture is called The Link Between Design and Storytelling. And so bottom line, we're going to talk about how artists, master artists, compose their artwork to convey their story or to share a feeling or emotion. And that's what this lecture is about. And so the way I like to start these lectures is just going through a couple quotes. And the first quote that we're going to look at is from Degas. And the reason why I do quotes is because it gives us a little context of the mind that these artists were working in. A lot of times we kind of project onto them what we know as art today. And when you really start getting into the history of how people made art, you'll actually find out that there's much that's very similar, but there's also a lot in the foundations of how we compose art, how we make art, that is kind of lost. And if you talk to an artist maybe between 70 and 90 years old, that was almost like the last generation that was really, really taught this information. And there's a couple of us who got lucky, 20, 30, 40 years ago, and were apprenticed by some of these older artists. And but sadly, they're kind of coming to the time where they're starting to die out. And there's a few of us out there who are bringing this information to the foreground. I will boldly say nobody's doing it like I do it. And the reason why is because I bring in the story aspect to it. There are some people out there who are teaching the foundations of design, but without the story, then all you're getting is how to, you're not understanding the why. And we want the why because that's where we inject the profoundness into the art. And I will show you what I mean as we move into looking at some of the artworks. So Degas, brilliant Degas. He says, art is not what you see, but what you make others see. And you'll find that a lot of these quotes and a lot of what I talk about is pulling away from the mindset that many artists have, which is copy what you see. This is what many art schools teach, copy what you see. And at the academy, we say, stop copying, start composing, because it's in composing that the artist has their power to communicate. If you're just copying, you basically are becoming a tool to your model, and the model is the artist, or the cityscape is the artist, or the still life is the artist, and you're just doing what it's telling you to do. So when we begin to look past what we see and begin to perceive this stuff, then we start to communicate with the muse, and amazing things can happen. So another quote, very similar to that one, is, it's not what you look at that matters, it's what you see. And again, this is talking about, it's not about the surface, it's not about the form that you look at, it's about looking past that and beginning to perceive, looking at the energy, the frequency of what you're looking at, tapping into the muse or the spirit of what you're looking at, being inspired, which means to be in spirit. And so when we only look at form and then we're copying, that's a great skill, and it's a great way of learning, you know, techniques in art. But when you're actually wanting to produce and put soul into your artwork, you got to look past that and begin to, it's not what you look at that matters, but it's what you see. Another great quote by the master Michelangelo is, a man paints with his brains and not with his hands. And so this again is leading us to this place that art is a work of the brain, okay? It's intellectual. And it's also conversation, right? So you're communing, you're conversating with this thing that you're making, as well as what it is that inspired you. And so when we're painting, it's something of the brain, not just of the hands. And so the great Picasso says, there are painters who transform the sun into a yellow spot. Yeah, you know, and look up at the sun and it looks like a circle and it's yellow. So I'm gonna paint a circle and make it yellow, and that's gonna be the symbol of the sun. And they're only looking at the form. But he says, thanks to their art and their intelligence, he says, there are some artists that then transform a yellow spot into the sun. And so when we look at that yellow spot, that circle that's yellow, and we begin to edit that, we begin to compose that little circle, and we look at the sun and we say, well, how does the sun shine? How does it radiate? How does it give off heat? How does it reveal? How do we feel its rays? Okay, when we start asking these questions, and we can't hold any of that in our hands. There's no form to that. There's only the effects of the sun. How do we convey the effects of the sun in our painting? That's when you start capturing the soul of the sun and putting it in your work. Let me know in the comments if that makes any sense. So the way we do that, the way we do that is, there are three things that we focus on at the academy, okay? Where we don't train people how to paint, we train people how to compose art. And let me go back here. There we are. So, excuse me. So, well, the first thing that we want to do is capture our story, capture our intent of a piece. And then the three areas that we're going to focus on are line. And so we need to ask a question. In every piece that you make or that you're appreciating, so when you go to a museum, Excuse me. Hold on a second. You know, you never cough until you need to talk. But that's all good. I love it. Cough away. So what happens is we want the story. We want the intent. And we want to compose every line in our design to support that story. Okay? So, for example, this is how important line is. If you notice this image on the left-hand side of the picture, what do you see inside that box? Put it in the comments. Tell me what you see. Some people, do you guys see the circles, obviously? Do any of you see a triangle in there? Yes or no? Do you guys see the presentation, the graphic? I'll make sure that you Oh, okay. Thank you, Keith. Page. No, I was clicking through some. Okay, give me 1 second. Let me reshare this here. It's good to know that you guys didn't see that. That way, I'm going to stop sharing my screen here for a second, and then I'm going to go ahead and reshare it. Okay, do you guys see this this screen that says how do lines support the story? Let me know just so before we move on. Okay, good. All right, so let's start from here now. Hey Don Nitram, nice to see you there, buddy. So let me back up again real quick, just now that you're looking at what I wanted you to see. You see the graphic on the left-hand side. And so what I was asking was, what do you see inside that graphic? Just type it in the chat box. A triangle. Man, what are you guys smoking? You eating mushrooms. There's no triangle there. The fact is that there really is no triangle there, but you see it. And this is part of what the artist gets to do. By managing the placement of our lines, we can trigger things in the mind of a person. We can trigger emotion. We can trigger that they feel that they're sure that they see something there, but it doesn't exist. That's an amazing power. I always say to my children, and I was just saying to one of the students the other day and to my friend this morning, the key in my many, many years of life, which hasn't been that many, but I have come to this conclusion that the ultimate key in life is the management of imagination. You have to manage your own imagination, because if not, you could be afraid of everything, or jealous of everything, or you could love everything, right? It's managing your imagination, but also managing other people's imagination too. And that's what we get to do as artists, man. We get to manage other people's imagination. We can put ideas in there, feelings in there. You know, somebody could feel like crap and come into our show, into our work, and bam, get hit by something that just raises their energy, raises their spirit, raises their attitude. What an amazing gift that we have. as image makers. So when we understand that we actually have power, you know, one day I'm going to write an essay on this, but I often talk about the difference between Rockwell and Hitler. And what amazes me is that they were both artists, but Rockwell used his art to create, Norman Rockwell used his art to create an idea of a nation as it ought to be. And so he didn't paint reality. He didn't paint really what was going on in his day. He was painting it as it ought to be. And so he inspired a whole nation to rise and rise its consciousness into a different place. And it's still inspiring people. Now, Hitler, on the other hand, used art and design to also inspire a nation. But obviously, it inspired it to a very, very evil end. And so both of these artists understood the power of their image making, and they intentionally went out and basically cultivated a society, a culture, a nation, based on the images that they put out in front of people. So as image makers, we are very, very powerful people. So when we make an image, we need to know our intent, which is our story, and we need to know how every line in that story supports, I mean, every line in that image supports our story. We also need to know space. We need to know how the space in our images support the story, okay? And we need to manage our values. Sometimes you'll see a person, they have a great idea, and they go to execute on the idea, and, you know, basically they want your eyeball to look in the top right-hand corner, but because the high point of contrast is in the top left-hand corner, it doesn't support the vision or the story, right? So if my intent as the artist is to move you to the top right and you're going to the top left, then I failed. That's the bottom line, okay? If my lines are directing you to the bottom right instead of the top right, if that was the intent, I failed. And I didn't. I failed as an artist because I failed, as Degas said, it's not, we don't. Art isn't what we see; it's what we make other people see. So if I want you to see something in the top right, and your attention is being pulled to the bottom left, or to the bottom, let's say the values are bringing you to the bottom left, and the line is bringing you to the top right, and this way that it's spaced is bringing you to the bottom left or bottom right. Well, now we have your eye being pulled in four different directions. And each layer of thought is a voice. So that's why they have to come in line with your intent. Because if they don't, then your painting, your image becomes schizophrenic. It has all these voices. And when people look at it, they may not be able to articulate because they don't know the language of design to say, oh, this is why this is making me feel this way. They just feel like there's something off and they don't know what it is, so they walk away. They might appreciate the fact that it's a nice painting, that it looks like the people, whatever, but they ain't buying it because something in them is off. They're not at peace, right, with the piece. And so that's why we have to manage all of these things. We are fabricators. That's awesome. Love that. Poetry of painting. So here is an artist. Do any of you guys know who the artist is in this example? Type it in the chat box if you know who the artist is here. Yep. So the artist on the right is Picasso. Does anyone know who the artist on the left is? The one with the little girl. That's right. They're both Picasso. The one on the left is Picasso when he was 14 years old. The other one when he was 50. And so as he grew, he experimented with different things. But the bottom line is Picasso was trained at a very, very early age by his father, who was an art teacher. It's interesting when you read the writings, the stories about Picasso. He talks about how his father would make him use a grid system. And he would then cut out pieces, and his father would teach him how to compose using the grid system. And that's something that we do at the academy. But actually, that little boy in the back, that's actually Picasso. He painted this when he was 14 years old. It's called The First Communion. And the girl on the chair is his sister, and that's his father and his mother in the background. But when you look at this, look at the lines that are in that piece, or because it's a painting, look at the edges, that's still a line. Look at the thrust and the lines, beautiful. Look at the spacing. Is there any place in that image that you feel like the space is not working? Look at the values. Is there any place in there that the values are not working? Now, I would say there is one slight error, in my opinion, but it is kind of just the nature of the forms, that the father is in this black outfit, and the daughter is in this white, and so it really does create a strong contrast. Now, it would have maybe been interesting if you wanted them to be focused on her reading the little book. Maybe the father could have been stepped a little further forward, and that way the contrast would have shifted to the front of her rather than the back of her. But, you know, he was 14 years old. So, but if you look at the image when he was 50, it's the same thing. Beautiful use of values, beautiful spacing. Is there any place in there that you feel like the spacing is off? The line work. The way that your eye moves through the piece, it's all there. And so I like to show this because it doesn't matter if you're a photorealistic artist or an abstract artist. Composition is composition. You've got to have an intent. You've got to have a story. And by story, I don't mean narrative necessarily. It could be, Cézanne said we're creating sensations, right? So it could be conveying a feeling, conveying an idea, sharing a feeling. It could be a narrative that you're telling a story. But either way, you have to have an intent. You have to know what it is that you want others to experience or get from the image. And then you design. You design with that intent in mind. And this is what Picasso is doing. And again, it doesn't matter what your style, it doesn't matter your medium, but it does matter your message. And I'm going to give a shout out to Martin, who basically came up with that concept, message over medium. Okay, so you can be a brilliant painter. Actually, Degas said this. He said, in my day, he said, there are better painters than I, people who could paint far better than Degas. But he said this, but because I remember I'm a draftsman first, and a draftsman is a composer, someone who's taking the time to actually architect the piece of art. Because I remember I'm a draftsman first, I will be the one that is remembered. And we remember him today. So he understood that there was a thing of legacy that was going on here. That there was, if you wanted your work to be preserved throughout time, you had to design it, or it just wasn't going to carry on. And that's a sad reality, because there's a lot of artists who spend 40, 50 years working hard, and they won't be remembered, you know? And because they're not composing for longevity, okay? So, again, just to refresh, and I'm going to bring this graphic up a bunch of times as we go through this, the art pieces that we're going to get into next. Story, line, space, value. How do your lines support your story? How do your spaces support your story? How does your value support your story? And so I'm going to go ahead and bring you in. If we're going to take a look at some artwork now, and we're going to ask those questions, and I'm going to show you how these masterminds, how these geniuses, engineered, architect, designed, composed their artwork. And when we say compose, we often think of composing in terms of music. So, all right, let's go there for just a moment. Have you ever seen a musician who can play by ear, right? They hear a song and they get on the guitar and they're beep, 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 you know, because that's the sound a guitar makes, right? they play by ear and they can hear it and copy it. It's the same thing that many artists can do who can copy what they see. Instead of the information coming through their ears, it's coming through their eyes, but it's coming out of their hands in such a way that they're just copying what they heard. But then there are some copiers, okay, who begin to infuse in their copying a style, somewhat of a voice inside of it, okay? But let me not say a voice, let's say a style, okay? And so they're still playing other people's music, but they're infusing their style into it. So, you know, someone takes a photograph and a painter takes it and he copies it. Now, he may use, because of his medium and his style, he may copy that image, that photograph in his style, okay? But he's still copying it. Now, so we have copiers, we have artists who are, you know, infusing the artwork, their style into what they're copying. And then you have composers. So in music, you have composers, people who know how to, one, read music, who know how to write music, who know how to think music and translate that in such a way and put it down on paper so that other people who are literate in music can take it and play it. Hmm? It's a very different place. And so we are composers. We get ideas. Da Vinci said that the work of the master is to conceive ideas, that's hearing the voice, and designing it. And the actual execution of the work, the actual painting or sculpting or whatever, is left for the lesser minds. Now, obviously, when he was growing through that system, he was a painter, you know, and a sculptor and an inventor and all those things. But as you come into a different level of your expression, it's like anywhere you work. The laborers are valuable because they're actually the ones who are manifesting the work, but they only get paid for a certain amount of effort, right? They only get paid a certain amount. The people who make the money are the people who come into management. And the management, they're not necessarily doing all the labor work, right? They're doing the thinking work. They're organizing the systems. They're making sure that everybody is in alignment, that there's harmony within sort of inside the corporation. This is what we do as artists, as composers. We want to make sure that inside the image, that the vision is casted and that it's following through. We set the culture, if you will, of that piece, okay? We manage the system so that everything is in harmony, everything is in unity, everything is in alignment, everything is working together for the picture, for the outcome, which is, like Descartes said, is making the people see something, okay? It's great that you see it, but if you can't show it to somebody else, then you're not an effective communicator, okay? And we, in the way that we communicate is through visions, through visual images, okay? So let's go ahead and jump into some work. Let's take a look at some artists. Okay, we're gonna focus on Rockwell here. And in Rocco, I want to really show you how he's using line. So I'm going to define line here in a second. I'm going to define line here for you right now. A line is basically any mark, any thrust, any edge, or any alignment that leads your eye. Okay, so if your eye is moving from one place to another, that is a line. Okay, when you're drawing and you actually put your pencil to paper, that's what we call a mark. Okay, the line actually extends forever, upward and downward, if you're making a vertical mark. So let me show you here. The purple line with the arrowheads, okay, that's going to represent the line. But the marks are a little dash, a long mark, and a point. Those are all different types of marks that lead us through that line, okay? So underneath, you can see it. You don't see the line, but you experience the line, okay? It moves you across, and you're using these little marks to move you across. So here's a dog, a long mark, and a couple points, and you can see now your eye is going up and down and up. It's like a little roller coaster, right? But there is no line that you're actually following that's visible. And so what you have to understand is that the artist who copies is concerned with making sure that they capture every visible thing that they see. The composer edits out as much of the visible stuff as possible, so there's simplicity, there's elegance, there's grace to it, okay? And what they're focused on is primarily designing the invisible part of the image. The marks, the part that you actually consciously see is important, but not nearly as important as the invisible part of your image. So in another form of communication, you know, like, let's say when we're talking, the scientists say, whoever the scientists are, they say that the words that are coming out of somebody's mouth, the actual words that are being used in communication, only equate for 7% of understanding. The other 93% comes from tonality, you know, like the way you use your voice up and down, okay? Body language. So between tonality and body language, that communicates far more than the actual words that you're using. You know, like if you have children or if you have a dog, let's say if you have a dog, you can say, come here, you know, stupid idiot, come here, stupid idiot. You know, the words don't matter. It's the energy in which you do it that the dog responds to. Same thing with children. You know, if you want to praise your child, you can use, you know, you wonderful creature, you know, divine creature, you. They don't know what the heck you're saying. But when you raise your voice, that triggers, they get what you're saying. They know that you're praising them, you're loving on them. You lower your voice, they know that they're in trouble, right? So one of the greatest things that has happened over the last 20 years is Batman. And what I mean by that is, when we were kids and Batman came on the animated series, I believe it was the first time that the actor actually used a different voice when playing Batman versus Bruce Wayne. And so there was a switch. You knew when Bruce was Batman, right? And what's interesting is I had my children who love Batman watch that old Batman from like the 60s, you know, that's on every Thanksgiving. And they're like, well, why does Batman sound like Bruce? Like, it was totally confusing to them. They didn't get it. So tonality is very, very important. And when we're designing, it's the same thing. Those are kind of like invisible things. You know, we want to manage the invisible part, the parts that we don't really, that we don't see. And in this case, line. So let's go ahead and get into some artwork. Since we're visual people, let's share the magic. This is the brilliant, amazing Norman Rockwell. I love Norman Rockwell. I've always have, and you know, I call him Norm. He calls me Don. On the weekends, we share Kool-Aid, and tell funny stories, and then I remember he's dead, and it kind of freaks me out. But we're going to look at this piece. What we see when we're looking at it is two football guys and a referee in the center, right? But this has nothing to do with football and a referee in the center. What this has to do with is something much smaller, okay? When Norman, I don't know if this happened, but I can imagine this is what happened. The art director from the Post calls Norm and says, Norm, we need a cover for this for next month or whatever, or maybe whatever the schedule is, right? And so Norm is, you know, in his studio trying to come up with a concept because the Masters, we conceive and we design. Norman Rockwell said, before I even think about color or texture, my drawing and my design have to be perfect, okay? That was his mindset. So he's in a studio, I can imagine in his studio, you know, he has this coin, you know, here's a penny, and he's flicking this coin up, right? He's like, okay, I gotta come up with an idea. I gotta come up with this idea. But if you notice, as I'm flicking this coin, notice how my hand curves out and comes back, and then the coin flips up in the air, right? It flicks up in the air, and at some point, when it gets about right at the apex, it just drops straight down to the floor. And I can imagine Rockwell saying, got it, Eureka, that's what I'm gonna do. I am going to illustrate the coin toss. Now, that's what we have here. This is the title of this painting, is called the coin toss. But the way we think is, oh, the coin toss. All right, we need two people from opposing teams. We need a referee, and he's tossing up a coin. No. He wants to convey the coin toss. I mean, the coin toss. The coin toss, okay? So how does he do it? So if you look at this image, and we are looking at line, he's going to take line, and he's going to move you through this image, okay? He's going to move you through this image. So let me show you how he breaks up this design. Notice the curve on the first guy's belly, okay? Notice the value shift down here where the trees are behind the guy. It's a dark tree, and then it goes light when the values come through. And that creates an edge that moves you through. It hits the bottom of his toes. It comes up, comes through these trees. Look how the curve on these trees back here. Move your eye up through this piece. Even up into the crease in the boy's head. And what does it do? All of these alignments, all of these marks, all of these edges move you to the coin, okay? That's the first part of the coin toss. So here we are. Put in the comments if you see that now. Type in the comments if you see how your eye is moving through, moving to that coin. Do you see that? Ellen sees it. Awesome. Cool. Excellent. I'm going to call you PJ, and if I'm mispronouncing your name, you tell me later if I am, okay? So now the next stage is, here's the coin toss, but now we have to have that coin drop to the ground, okay? Look at that beautiful thing. So what happens is, if you notice that the referee is almost purely constructed of verticals, what does that do? PJ came first. Awesome. The lines force your eye to go wham very quickly. Why? Because there's nothing really there to obstruct it. Okay. Now we're lucky that the referee also has stripes in his shirt, right? Because that helps us force the eye down. If the guy didn't have stripes in his shirt, Norm would have figured something else to make our eye bam drop with such force. Okay. The legs, bam, verticals. The center of the leg, verticals. Everything is just, it goes from that coin. Look at the verticals on the side of that man's head. Right? Soon. It looks like the guy doesn't even have ears. Why? Because you have to design your ears so that your eye goes through them. So everything that's in this man, from his thumbs up, bam, it brings us down, straight down to where that coin is going to land. Do you see how Norman designed the coin toss? And the figures, the referee, the two players, the trees, the people in the back, those are all the visuals that help him actually, you know, give that flesh out his composition. But he's composing, he's designing. This is the design. Now, when he goes and he draws on top of that design, you know, that has to be done to his level in his style, okay? But before he gets into that, he has to figure out the design work. Do you guys see this? Do you guys feel this? Here. Here's both the flipping of a coin and the dropping of a coin. Just look at that piece now and let your eye now begin to move through it. Right? It is brilliant. And now you're not even looking at the people anymore. Before, you looked at the people and you were trying to figure out the story based on the nouns. So what I like to say at the Academy is this. Dog fence. What happened in that story? Well, I don't know. But if I say dog jumps over fence, what happened in that story? You get it? So to say that the painting is about a referee and football players and a coin, it's boring. It's not active. There's no spirit. The word spirit means the thing that actually animates an idea or a feeling or a thought, okay? Spirit is the energy that activates a feeling, an idea or a thought, okay? So there's no spirit once you remove the verb. Dog, fence, okay. You put spirit in that thing. You put energy in that thing. You put verb in that thing. And now you have something. He's animating through this image the coin toss. Cool? Let's move on to the next one. So we got story, and we looked at line. And of course, there's space and value that we could have gone into with that image, but we're gonna touch on value in this one. But let's look at line again. This one is called Ecstasy by Maxfield Parrish, another brilliant illustrator. He was also a Pennsylvania guy. So any fellow Pennsylvanians out there, woohoo! The story is understand. Let me read something here real quick. Indeed, PJ. But I want to, with your comment there, PJ, I want you to also add to that. It's just not, we do understand the story, and it is something that we all have experienced before, right? That we can identify with. But what I want to caution you on is just to make sure that you're not saying that sentence and saying that we are identifying necessarily with the form of it, which we are, you know, that's the cultural part of it, okay? But what's activating us, what's actually moving our eyes, because when your eyes move in a certain way or when your eyes take in a certain alignment, it's stimulated in such a way, okay? So like a hard contrast on something, it can repulse us. Make us, you know, it can, you know, or it can put us at ease. And so as composers, we want to learn the psychology of how people relate to certain arrangements of values or certain arrangements of line. So for example, when you paint a, let's say a king, right? Let me ask you guys, if you're going to paint a king, would you, or not paint a king, when you're composing or designing a king in an image, would you mainly use vertical lines or would you use horizontal lines? Tell me which one you would use. Just put a V for vertical and an H for horizontal. Yes, exactly, the V. Now, unless you're creating a king during peacetime, or maybe a very irresponsible king, or a king who became king but really isn't a king in his heart, right? Then you might use a lot of H's, okay? Oh, a key, okay, yeah. All right, very cool. But yes, you're gonna use a lot of V's, verticals. Why? Because the vertical, that vertical thrust, that vertical alignment, that vertical edge, that vertical line, that vertical mark is strength. Exactly. It is strong. It is stable. You are not going to mess with it. Now, let's say that king, right, we see him, and now let's look at the background. He's a wartime king. He needs energy. He needs to fight, right? He needs to win. Would you construct the background mainly in verticals, diagonals, or horizontals? Put a V, D, or an H in there. If he's active, diagonals, exactly. You guys already get this. This is beautiful. Why? Because it's action, okay? The diagonal, let's just say it's phallic, right? I mean, it's, you know, it's aggressive, right? Now, if he's a peacetime king, so we know he's vertical, do we want to use energy, movement, aggression? Exactly. If he's a king during peacetime and we're going to compose the background, would you compose it mainly in horizontals, verticals, or diagonals? Exactly. Do you see? We never talked about what was in the background. Would it be a castle, a bunch of a harem of women? Would it be cities or vineyards? We didn't get into any of that. We already know whatever goes into the background has to be designed in horizontal thrusts, because that triggers in the viewer peace, rest, right? So here we just use three different lines, and we have 360 lines we can use, and a whole bunch more than that because of fractions. But we picked out three lines and communicated a whole bunch of different ideas. Beautiful, profound ideas. Just not a king, you know, a guy with a little hat, right? All right, I get a little passionate about this. So let's move on. Maxfield Parrish, another brilliant mind, another amazing composer. Ecstasy. What is ecstasy? The sense of being lifted off the ground, raptured into the sky, right? So that's what he's doing here. So we've already looked at line, so let's take a look at how he's using the line. You see all of these diagonal thrusts. All of these diagonal thrusts are moving us from this bottom left-hand corner to the top right-hand corner. Right? It's pushing us up off that rock. So here it is. Do you see that now? Once I take those lines away, do you actually feel that energy? How your eye is starting to move? You could almost begin to feel the clouds moving past her in the back. You can feel almost like the fabric of that thing, of her dress and stuff, animating up into that direction. Right? Why? Because he's managed his lines, which are triggering something in our minds. Ooh, I like the way that rhymes. Well, that's another rhyme. Just three rhymes in a row. Okay, sorry. It's lifting us up off of that rock, right? So now let's look at value, okay? So value, so we know the story, to lift her up off of the rock. So we're going to bring in value, and I'm going to show you how he uses value to communicate the same exact thing. So he's supporting the story. We know the story. We know he's used line to tell that story. Now we're going to look at value. So value simply is the relationship between the lights and the darks in your image. Okay? some, and inside that, there's different relationships of these values. At the Academy, we use a 9-value system, okay? So you can look at the first grouping. There's a light bar behind it and a darker bar underneath it, right? That's your background. So the 3 circles in the first grouping are high contrast. It's a white, a black, and a 50% gray, okay? So it's 0, 100%, and 50%, okay? Those are big contrast differences, okay? And then when you look at it against a light background versus a darker background, it changes things. For example, look at the white against the light background. It almost fades away. It's not nearly as important as the white on the dark background, right? So if we go to the second grouping, those are all kind of like a middle, like a darker range. Again, when that dark is put on a light background, simultaneous contrast happens. So the light becomes lighter, the dark becomes darker. There's all these little nuances that you have to be mindful of. But what we're going to do is learn how to use value to do what? Tell your story, okay? And then you can see this grouping of light values over here. So here's the image in black and white. We take away color because we just want to look at the values. Notice that there are about 2 heavy parts of contrast outside of the top left-hand corner where the cloud meets the darkness of the sky. Okay, but let's look at the woman. Her hair is pretty dark, right, against that cloud and against the sky. And what does that shape do? It moves us in the alignment that he of those diagonals, right? It moves us in that same line. If we come down and we look up underneath our skirt, hey guys, calm down. We're not gonna look up our skirt, we're just gonna look at her, the bottom of our skirt, okay? So at the bottom of her skirt, it also is pulling us up as well, okay? But when we get to her feet, notice the contrast, the hard contrast on those rocks. What's happening now is the contrast in those rocks are pulling our eye in a different direction. Let's take a look at what's happening here. Do you see this? How the diagonals and the value contrast above her skirt is pulling us up to the top left, top right-hand corner, or in that direction, I should say. Where her feet are pulling us down. So when our eye comes down on her, and all of a sudden our eye starts to pull apart. Now, if you look at the image, her feet are on the ground. According to the form, according to what we see, her feet are on the ground. But if you do not know how to read a painting, if you don't know how to read the lines and the values, then you miss this whole thing. Right? This is freaking brilliant. This is a genius piece. She's floating up off the ground. Now, you might think I'm slightly insane for saying this, but let me tell you something. It's not the first time Maxfield did this. Check this one out. This is Icarus, another Maxfield painting. So we look at a high point of contrast, the black of his head against the light of that cloud, right? We come down, we can see the diagonals are very, very clear. In the wings. Also, look at that sword that he's holding, right? But this is the key. The sword is not important in this piece, in this story of Icarus, but it is absolutely crucial in this design. Why? Because as our eye comes down, it creates a diagonal. And look at the plane in which his feet are on. It's pulling us down. Same technique that he used in the last one. Here, okay? And that horizontal line probably should be on a diagonal that's pulling us down, because that's a little truer to the image, okay? This would be your dominant horizontal down here. So, again, he's pulling us. Why? Because Icarus wants to fly. Notice how Icarus almost feels like this high point of contrast is here, and if you're looking at this, you almost feel like he's swinging off, like he's not even on the cliff anymore. your eye wants to draw that plumb line, and he's kind of already up and off the edge of that, right? But this is amazing. He uses the value, he separates it, Chris. And look at, when we bring it back in color, even the color of the clouds and the color of his legs merge. And so visually they're there, but when we're looking at it and we're just experiencing the piece, his feet go here to here. His feet become the back of that sword. If you squint your eyes just a little bit, all of a sudden Icarus isn't standing on the cliff anymore. He's floating, he's hovering, right? Cool? This is what design does for the artist. It takes them into a whole nother level of power. You want to produce profound work, then you need to know how to communicate through this language. So those great ideas that we have are actually conveyed. This is bullshit to tell somebody to go into a gallery when an artist slaves away on a canvas and then to tell them, interpret whatever you want. We would never go to a movie and go watch, you know, some horror movie and walk out laughing. Oh my God, that was the greatest comedy ever. You'd be insane, right? I mean, people spend millions and millions of dollars making movies to tell a story. And they want 80%, if not more, of the people who go to that theater to walk away with a common experience, right? Now, of course, we're all different. We're going to have some little variations. It might be because of something in our past or whatever, something else might be triggered that wasn't necessarily intended. And that's wonderful. That's beautiful. But just to say to people, whatever, you know, you look at the artwork. Now, go screw yourself. I am not going to sit here and write a book, perform a music, compose a music, make a movie, another art form, okay? But when we're visual artists, it's okay just to interpret whatever. No. We had a vision. There was something that inspired us. We were inspired. We were in spirit. We were in that energy. And we went to that canvas to produce that thing, to make that thing happen. Sadly, most of us don't know the language to actually make it happen. So we focus on forms and we focus on this and that, and it becomes something lesser. But when you understand design, you get to actually communicate your ideas. You make people feel it. You make people see it. You make people feel it. And by feeling it, what I mean is they're getting it even if they can't articulate it. Okay? So this is what Max Phil did here, twice using this very similar technique. So we've seen story, right? We know the story, that's the intent. We've seen artists use line. We've seen artists use value. Now let's get into space a little bit. Actually, no. Let me give you one more example of line let me give you another example. This is the brilliant Edward Hopper. Let me ask you guys, when you look at this piece, if you start at the top left-hand corner, because in Western culture, we've been trained to read from top left across and down, so that's kind of how our eye is trained to move. So we're going to start at the top left-hand corner. And we move across. When you squint your eyes, where is the highest point of contrast? Write it in the comment there. Is it in the top of the image? Is it somewhere in the middle of the image? Is it in the bottom of the image? Is it on an object? Just to verify, do you guys see this painting, the Edward Hopper painting? Just type yes. I want to make sure that we didn't have a... Okay, so you're saving the window, so that means you guys are seeing it. Great. The highest point of contrast in this, most people say it's the barber pole, okay? But I'm going to say it's not. Okay, you can make an argument for both because it is the light area against the black, and so that white on black is high point of contrast. So let's call that the high point of contrast. But what I'm going to say is the most important contrast, okay, in this image is in the sky. So you notice at the sky, first of all, this painting for the most part is a very warm painting, right? So he controls everything, the building, everything down is warm except for the blue inside of the barber pole. But the sky is cool, right? So it's moving across from a darker value to a light value, but when it gets to the end on the right-hand side, it stops, right? And it just like, I mean, it's such a hard contrast, it just rips out and like, bang! It like punches you in the eyeball. You're like, ah, like, why the hell would he do that? What is that thing? And if you're looking for form, and you're looking for what is it, you're gonna miss it. So let's not ask what is it, let's ask why is it? Good question, right? Why is it? What is its function? Because he's a master painter, he's a master composer. So why in the world would he put such a hard contrast there? Well, let me show you why. It is absolutely, boom, exactly. It is absolutely vital that he gets your eye to really start at that section of the painting, okay, rather than starting at the top left. So he shoots you across. There is absolutely nothing in there that's stopping us. It shoots us straight across to the right hand side of the image, and then bam, he stops us right there. Now look at the alignment. If you follow your eye down, it comes right into alignment with the edge of that window, right? If you continue down, you can see that there's a door, but it doesn't come in alignment with that door. So there is a line that's created there. Now, look at those three windows. Do you notice that there's a diagonal in those windows? Helen, it's uncomfortable. Absolutely, it is uncomfortable. But he moves us quickly down from that uncomfortable area by having this alignment in the windows. So it's bam, drops quickly, okay? If this window was a little over to the right or a little to the left, it wouldn't drop so quickly, we would actually get stuck there, okay? So bam, bam is what happens. He gets us into this area where the windows are. So there's an alignment of these windows. They create a diagonal, what we call a thrust. There really isn't a line per se. I mean, there is a line because it goes from the point to point to point and underneath, and it's creating this thrust, okay, this diagonal movement. Now, when we come to this third window in, notice the fourth window where it's yellow, it's horizontal. That moves our eye across, horizontal, across. We come to the third one, the sixth window in, a diagonal. Notice that diagonal leads us to this really weird shadow that forms these strong diagonals, right? So what the hell did he just do? Why did he do that? Here's what's happening. Our eye goes across, it comes down, and now he's just created a wash, a flow, a subtle, exactly, a subtle washing over. Now he does it in line, because as when we are developing things in 2D on flat surfaces, we need to communicate with straight lines. Curves are beautiful, graceful, but it's really the direction, like those lines that move us. Also, it's important because our eye doesn't move smoothly. It moves like in staccato. It's like pop, 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 pop. So by giving it a point, a line, it gets pop, pop, right? Pop, 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 pop. So when we're composing point-to-point line relationships, we're actually giving the eye a way to actually move through the piece more naturally. So pop, 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 that's what he does, because he's trying to get us to flow through this piece. Now, why would he do that? So we started in the blue band, we came down, we went through the red band, and now we're in the green band down at the bottom. Okay, so before we move on, I want you guys to take a look at this and just feel it. Do you feel how your eye is moving across, descends, flows over the top? It's almost like something's moving through that piece, but you can't see it. And now we're at the bottom area with the green, okay? We're in the lower part of the painting now. It brings us back, okay? The alignments in the canopies, the windows, the text on the windows, all of those are what? Horizontal thrusts. It's moving us back now from left to right. And as we go back, we go up and over, we go past the hydrant, right? Because our eye, the hydrant doesn't actually stop us. Our eye continues to move, and it comes to the barbicule, which stops us. But this is amazing with the barbicule. When you look at it, you think that the barber pole and the fire hydrant are verticals, don't you? But watch this. If we draw a vertical line, they're not verticals. They're diagonals. Look at the barber pole. Look at the awning. They're diagonals. They're not vertical. Look at the highlight on that fire hydrant. It's diagonals. What does that mean? Let me demonstrate for you. If you can see me, I'm sitting vertical. This is what they're doing. Do you see it? They're leaning back. So whatever this thing is that is washing over them, that's washing above them, they're leaning back into it. They're standing in the awe of it. This is why it's called early Sunday morning. It was painted in a time, what did people do on Sunday morning? They went to church. Now, this may be early Sunday morning, right before they go to church. And he's talking about, he's communicating this idea and this feeling of worship, of just standing in the natural awe of life. Look at the high contrast. There is a bright source of light coming from that side. Look at the contrast, those long shadows that are being produced. Do you guys see this? Do you feel it? This thing is washing over top of this, the building, the pole, whatever it is. You can call it God. You can call it life. You can call it awe. You can call it just whatever it is, but you have a sense of peace. It's amazing, right? And you don't have peace because you don't see people. Well, I can't see into the buildings, a lot of people say. They're looking for the forms to tell them what the painting is about. But when you can look at the why, you can look at, you know, the design, the composition behind it, now it tells you everything. There is a motto that I love that says, if you follow the design, it tells you the story. Follow the design, it tells you the story. And I love doing this when I go to a museum. Look at the design, articulate the design, let it tell you what the story is, and then look at the title. And almost 80 to 90% of the time, bam, you'll be able to figure out the title. I remember I was at a local museum here, and there was a painting. And I'm looking, it was like a figure with this woman on a hill, right? And she's in this flowing dress. And most people would look at it and think, oh, the painting is about the lady in the dress. Nah. You follow the design and you look past the obvious. And when you squint your eyes, her dress fades into the background. She basically fades away. Very low contrast between her, the sky, and the background. But the heavy point of contrast was between, it was this gap between trees. And I said, huh, if I ask the design what it is, the design is telling me that this has nothing to do with the woman. It has to do with the air. It has to do with the breeze, the wind. It's like a spring wind that's blowing through these trees. That's where my focus is going to. And I look at the painting, and it's called Summer Breeze. Bam, another one in the books. Bing! This stuff is fun when you get it. You're just like, holy crumoly, you know. Michelle, one of the ladies at the Academy and a local popular famous artist around here, she took her son to the Barnes Foundation, and she said, I had the absolute best time in an art museum I've ever had in my life. And she took her son, she showed a couple principles to her son, and for 3 hours, they looked at a couple paintings, just blown away by all of the story that was going on. In the past, she would go in, she'd look at paintings, an hour later, she was sitting waiting for everybody else because she didn't know what to look for. Now she does. Now she's going and having the best time that she's ever had in her life in a museum. This is what design does. If I give you a book, you know, it could be something that's, you know, like a Dr. Seuss book, or it could be a Bible. It could be, you know, books on metaphysics or physics or science, whatever it is. If you're illiterate, you might be able to appreciate the cover of that book. You might open it up and say, wow, look at the cool pictures and look at the neat text or symbols. This is cool, right? But if you can't decode that language and understand what the author coded in those symbols, you will never get the power that was put in those books, right? It's the same thing with a painting. You can appreciate, oh, that's pretty. That looks like something I experienced before. Great, cool. Now read the damn painting. Read it. But if you can't, it's what we call visual literacy. If you're visually illiterate, you cannot either author a book, okay, we call paintings visual essays, because you're writing a freaking book. You're telling a story, and the language we're using is design, and the grammar that we use is composition, okay? Now, so we need to become visually illiterate so that we can author amazing works, and we can also go back and read the brilliant work of the people in the past. It's amazing, the ideas, the profound ideas that these people were sharing with us that speak to us today if we know how to read their design. And I'm going to show you one next, which I'm sure a couple of you guys have already seen. Maybe you've seen the video online of it, but I'll share it with you next. So we've looked at a little bit of value, some lines value, and how they support the story. So this round, we're going to get into space. We're going to get into value, space, and line. So this is a painting by Emile Ferrand, and it's called All Saints Day. Tell me if you guys already seen this video, analyzation online. Let me know. Yeah. Well, PJ, you're gonna see it again. So sit back in your chair and enjoy. So those who haven't seen it, get ready. Okay. I feel like the macho man Randy Savage of art. Oh yeah. Anyways, okay. Here is a painting of a group of people, adults, walking past this fella who's asking for some charity. If you notice the high contrast in the back that creates this diagonal, all those black marks back there that's against that high that point of contrast, that light area, are actually other people in black robes going to All Saints Day. Now, what's interesting is they're bringing these flowers, I guess, to give and celebrate a bunch of dead people. And that's cool. The reason why I'm saying it that way is because it ties into this painting. So the first thing that we want to look at is a curve. Do you guys see this curve that's created? Type yes if you see a curve that's created in the top left-hand corner between that dark value, that dark cool value, and the light warm value here. You see that edge, it creates a curve? Type in yes, okay. So as your eye follows through, notice comes up through the trees, comes down through the women, it goes into their back, okay? It creates this curve. as your eye looks at the women who represent the adults in this painting, your eye lifts up and over the poor man. That contrast in the top left-hand corner serves to pull your eye up and over him. What does this do to the viewer? It causes us to ignore the man. There's nothing here to look at. Just keep walking on by. And our eye goes up and over him. It is a way of communicating that we are ignoring him. Now, ultimately, in the bottom part of the image, he has another value contrast that brings us back through, another value contrast down here, another value contrast. You see, these all create edges that ultimately bring us back to the little black tin cup with his white sign, which is a strong contrast. But along with that, there is a very strong vertical in this piece. It's what we call the dominant vertical. The dominant vertical. And that thing, it comes down into his arm, and then his arm bends, causing the eye to go from one point to another, from that point to the point, basically to the cup. Okay? Bam! Okay? The diagonal that's created in the high point of contrast of the people in the background and the people in the ground and the foreground move us to him. We have a dominant horizontal. Again, coming straight to him. And we have a vertical that's in the, I mean a vertical, a diagonal that's coming from the little girl's hand up to the man. I also like the fact that all of these things don't go to his cup, per se. The majority of them come to his face, to his humanity. Not to his need, but to his humanity. Do you hear that? This painting isn't about ministering to his need. It's about ministering to his humanity. Let me move forward, and then that'll make more sense. So we're going to get into space. So space is basically everything that's around a line. See, as composers, we understand this. Space is empty. We've got a piece of paper, it's empty. But it's really not empty because it's just full of all of this energy. And the way that you activate the energy in that space is by making a mark. And when you make a mark, that gives you that line. And a line has three properties. It has a motion, a movement, the direction in which it's going in, moves your eye. That direction, like we talked about with the king, vertical, diagonal, horizontal, it conveys, it triggers an emotion, right? Or a mood, okay? And a line has a mark. That's actually the point in which when the line is actually made real. It's made, not real, but made manifested, okay? Where we can actually, it's made conscious, okay? So the line is subconscious. The mark on our paper is the conscious part. It's the tip of the iceberg, but the line is what's underneath the water. Got me? So when you make that mark, hold on 1 second. Nancy is requesting remote control of your share content. I am sorry, Nancy. I'm going to politely decline. When you make a mark and it activates a line, everything around it that's not activated yet is space, okay? So here's a line that goes across or a mark that goes all the way across. Everything above it, underneath it, to the side, in front and behind it is space. Inside of this rectangle, everything above it and inside of it is space. Very simple concept. Very, very simple concept. I try to keep it simple because I want you guys to be freaking amazing. And if I try to make it overly complex just to say, ooh, look what I know, then people will say, man, he's full of himself. And he might know a lot, but it's not powerful for me because I can't use it. So that's why it's taken me 25 years to figure out this stuff and to be able to communicate it in such a way that you get it, okay? So when we get into gridding and we get into space, it can get very complex. But what I want you to remember for right now is that we deal with three boxes, okay? One is a square, we deal with what we call a main or a mother rectangle, and we deal with a reciprocal or a daughter rectangle. That's it. So if you want to say the square is the dad and the main one is the mom and the small one here is the daughter, go ahead and say it that way, okay? Now, I want to show you the relationships of how we get these three measurements of space, okay? You have to understand, first of all, that composing is math. But lucky for you, we don't ever deal with math because we are spatial thinkers, not mathematicians. Okay, at least most of us aren't. So I don't want to get into math. I would rather my brain do all the calculating, but my consciousness, my awareness, my intelligence stay with the spatial intelligence, okay? So we're only going to deal with things that we can see. But when we have a rectangle, look at the mother rectangle. We have a certain height to her. And our mind calculates immediately. When we see that height, it already knows where the square is. Because if it has this height and that's vertical and it brings it the same distance across to where, you know, horizontally, that gives us a square. And that's what you see there. So if you look at the red lines, those all those lines are exactly equal. Okay? So we have a square, it has four of the same equal sides. In the mother rectangle, we're using the height. Now, if we take the mother rectangle, which is right now horizontal, and we pivot it 90 degrees, we just make it go from horizontal to vertical. We make it go from a landscape orientation to a portrait orientation. Same rectangle, just flip it. And we now shrink that rectangle down so that the new height of that new rectangle is identical to the mother. That's what we call a daughter rectangle. It's called a reciprocal. So these are the three boxes that we use when composing space. Okay? Every rectangle has a square in it. Every rectangle. From the square comes all rectangles. If you extend the square out, you have a horizontal rectangle. If you extend this, if you shrink the square inward, now it becomes portrait, right? It becomes a vertical thrust to the rectangle. So the basis of every rectangle is a square. And if we take that rectangle and we flip it and we shrink it so that the two sides are identical, now we have a relationship, okay? So this is very important. So let's get back into the image and see how Emil uses this concept to actually compose this story. So everybody, in the comments, tell me what rectangle that is. Is that a reciprocal, a mother, or a square? So just type in M, R, or S. Well, I'm glad you guys said square because you're absolutely wrong, but let me clarify something real quick. The mother rectangle is the rectangle, in this case specifically, is the rectangle that the picture is consumed in, okay? It's the outer edge of the image, okay? So therefore it's the big rectangle. Okay, it is wider than a square, exactly. So this is the mother rectangle. Now if we take that rectangle and we flip it and we scale it down, it gives us a reciprocal. And we're bringing it in from the left side. Now what we can do also is bring it in from the right side. So let's go ahead and do that. What? What just happened? Did Emil intentionally take a rectangle and flip it, double it up, and create a space where he isolates the little girl? Did he just do that? Look at that. Brilliant. On one side are the adults. Look how perfectly they're aligned. Exactly. The little girl is isolated in the middle. The man is positioned right inside that triangle on the left-hand side. You also notice on that rectangle, there's nothing really in the on the left-hand side of that rectangle. It creates a triangle here. It almost feels like an arrow that's pointing you in that direction, moving the eye. But the whole point of this piece is that the adults are ignoring him going to the church, right? So he isolates him. The little girl who has the faith of a child, who sees the humanity, whose arm isn't going to the, she's not looking at this guy and saying to him, oh, he's just a needy bum on the, he just wants my money, right? She's looking at, everything's pointing to his face. She's looking at the fact that he's a human being. And she is extending love. She's extending grace. She's extending mercy. She's extending humanity to this man, right? That's what this arm is about. And Emil isolates her and puts the band there. You see how now you can use space to help support the story. Brilliant. Let's look at value. We've already talked about the high value contrast, and that helps create this diagonal and this horizontal that comes to the man's face. It also gives us a value here that allows us to look at the tin can here. But there's also a little value shift in her hand. When I was studying this painting, I saw a little white mark in her hand, and I said, huh, look at Emil screwed up. Maybe some paint dripped or something. And then I punched myself in the face and said, what the hell are you talking about? This is a master composer. They don't screw up like that. If I see a little value shift in that hand, in this whole entire painting, this little tiny shift, this little mark, then he's intentionally made me see that. So I said, all right, let's look a little closer and see what's going on here. Maybe something isn't messed up. I look in. I go into the painting. Do you guys see that cut in her hand? Yes or no? Do you see the value shift in her hand? Yes. She's holding something, right? Does anyone take a guess, except for PJ and the people at the Academy? Anybody have a guess what she's holding? A coin. We would think that because we would think that the guy's asking for money, right? We would think, okay, but let me ask you a question. What would a little girl, especially during those days, have a coin for? There's something to think about. And remember, she's not going to the cup. She's going to his face. So I couldn't figure out what she was holding. I thought it was a coin at first too. And then I looked closer and I realized, holy crap. Right above her hand is something. It's like a little rectangle and it's warm. And right behind her hand is cool. But they're the same value, so it's hidden. The only way that you can see it is by paying attention to the value, the temperature shift, the warm against the cool. And what we realized, exactly, it is a little flower. She's holding a little flower, a warm one. So she probably plucked it from her parents, her mom's or grandmother's or whatever, okay. She just wants to extend a flower, one little flower to this man. Interestingly enough, think about this. They're taking all these flowers to what? To go give to dead saints. She wants to take one and give it to a living one. Kind of cool. You see the profoundness of this when you start getting into the composition and the story that this man in his studio was thinking about. You know, he gave let's say the church who may have commissioned this, I don't know, but let's just assume it was, he gave them what they wanted, a celebration of All Saints Day. But you could tell he was a thinker, because come on, man, people who compose at this level are not like, you know, drooling on canvases. Oh, what a paint. No. They're thinking, they're engineering. This is what Picasso said. There are some artists, thanks to their what? Their art and their intelligence. Remember Michelangelo? Painting is not a thing of the hands. It's a thing of the mind. It's a thing of the brain. Right? These people were intelligent. They were profound people. They had something to say, and they had the language to say it in. This is an essay. This was painted, who knows, what, 300, 400, 500 years ago, whatever it was. And it's a conversation we can have today. PJ, I find their eyes interesting. Were the eyes, were they directed? My story is that the grandmother and the mother had directed the child to give of herself something. See, you're looking at a form, PJ, and then you're interpreting what that form may mean, okay? And that's what most people do. We look at the form and we interpret it what we think it would mean. That's why you have to look at the energy. You have to look at the verb. If I say dog fence, I'm looking at the form, and then I say, well, you know, the dog is peeing on the fence, or the dog is laying by the fence, or the dog is, you know, hanging out with another dog by the fence, you know what I mean? You know, but if we look at the verb, and the verb says jumping versus humping, well, then we know what the dog is doing, right? So I would agree that, yeah, their eyes are doing something, but the design tells us a whole nother story. The design says that these people are moving up and over. The design, when we break it up, says that the parents, the adults are isolated. They're apart from this thing. That it is the little girl who's done something. If you look at the feet of the design of the feet of the adults, they're just moving straight across on horizontal. Her feet are angled. She's stepping out, moving towards them. So one could say, well, the parents, gave the little girl the flower to do it. I'm going to say no, because the design overwhelmingly tells me something else. You know, this guy has a little cup. Is his cup overflowing with money or flowers? Yes or no? Yes or no? And you see one flower with him? No. But look at all of the people, the 50, 60, 100 people who walk by him. And he has a little tiny cup. It's not overflowing. There's no flowers laying at his feet. So that tells me, again, the adults are passing over him. Exactly. Sad indeed. And PJ, I'm glad I got to smash your thought live. But it's done in love and for the expansion of our minds, okay? So we can be profound, amazing, powerful artists. Beautiful. At least you have, PJ, the courage to speak your mind. That's a beautiful thing. Okay. Would you guys like to see one more? I mean, I'm willing to wrap it up and call it the day if you want, but if you want to see, oh, what? More, yes. Okay, all right, I'll show you one more. This stuff is so fun. I'll tell you, my ex-wife and I, years ago, we took a, you know how people go garage selling, they go around to garage sales on a Saturday. We used to like going Craigslisting, just find crap on Craigslist and go buy it. And And so one day, I saw a Craigslist ad for like these plates, these Norman Rockwell plates. I said, oh my gosh, we gotta go, you know? Because one day in my life, I want to own like a couple real, genuine Norman Rockwell paintings. So I was like, well, let me just start it now. You know, I'll get the little plates or the little posters, whatever. So we drove down to Maryland and we bought these plates. And then we got back home and I said, Evelyn, watch this. I didn't know the names of these paintings, but I went through 38 plates. And if you look at what was represented there, you would say, oh, this is what it's about. But the design always said something different. So Norman Rockwell, when he would design, he would give the people what they needed consciously, but his design would give them what he wanted subconsciously, right? It was a different story. So I would just quickly, just like I'm doing here, just analyze the design. I would say, you know, this painting is about blah, 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 in a couple words. And out of 38 plates, around probably 34 or 35, I was almost word for word, I said the name of the painting. It was amazing. And if you read the name of the painting, it was like, huh? You know, like it really didn't have that much to do with the direct part of the image. It only had to do with the verb, the story, what was actually being said through the design. And that was an amazing day. That really, it was one of those moments where I was like, holy shit, like this stuff is real and I know what I know, you know? and I love when people at the academy, when they go, like I said earlier about Michelle going to the museum, I love when people are starting to communicate this and see it. And it's a joy. So, let's do one more, okay? I'm gonna click it, get ready. So we talked about story, line, space, and value. So let me break up, let me share another bit of knowledge with you guys here. In those rectangles that you, those boxes that you saw earlier, you saw the cross, the crisscross, going from the top left hand to the bottom right hand corner and the bottom left hand corner to the top right. There are names for these rectangles. We have horizontals, we have 90 degree angles or a right angle, we have verticals. But when we have an angle that goes from a top left to a bottom right, we call it a sinister angle. So this is a sinister diagonal or a sinister angle or a sinister thrust, okay? If you're dealing with value and it creates an edge, we call it a sinister edge, okay? So if your eye moves from the top right to the bottom left, it is a sinister. Now, sinister doesn't mean evil. What it means is sacred, okay? What it means is secretive. It is something that you don't want people to really see, okay? Now, the reason why this works psychologically on us is because, remember, we start at the top left-hand corner and we read across and then down and ultimately we want to get to the bottom right-hand corner. So this angle, it dramatically pulls us straight down to the bottom, to the end. And what it does is as it's doing that, we see what's below it, but what's above it, we just glance by it and it feels like we didn't get everything we were supposed to see. Okay? That's the psychology that's happening. So, hold on 1 second. Read across, yes. Back into. Okay, so now if we push back into the space, if we come from the bottom left-hand corner going to the top right-hand corner, as our eye moves into that space, we call it a Baroque. Remember, Baroque paintings were made large and they were designed to invite the people into it. See, when we had that Renaissance movement, when we had that going from the Renaissance to the Baroque movement, there were a bunch of things that occurred in human culture at that time. We had a huge Reformation, okay? There was the Catholics. The Catholics mainly owned the Renaissance time. If you looked at the paintings of the Renaissance, a lot of times it was about noblemen, rich men, you know, Medici's and these guys, and and their dealings with the church and the people. And oftentimes they were designed vertically and horizontally. The composition was just two-dimensional inside that space. When the Baroque came, it was during the Lutheran, the time of Luther. So it was the Protestant Reformation. It was a pulling away from the church. And at that time, the concept of God, church, was Luther basically read in the scriptures said that people are saved by grace, not works. So at that time, the idea was that if you wanted to go to heaven, you had to pay money, you had to, you know, beat yourself, you had to do all kinds of crap, right? And what triggered in him was the fact that it's done by grace. Works don't, it doesn't matter, but it's not what got you in, right? Quote, unquote. So also during that time, it was that huge separation, the printing press was invented. So now you could give Bibles to the common people, where before the Bibles were only held by the elites, right? Because they were very expensive to make. But now you could print a whole bunch of them up, and it got into the hands of the people. That's why Catholic countries tend to have a very low literacy rate, and Protestant countries tend to have a very high literacy rate, because they would use their Bible to educate, and so therefore people were reading the Bible, and therefore they were learning how to read. In the cultures, the Christian faith that didn't really have that as part of their culture, the people didn't read, and so the literacy rate was down. Music changed. Bach, who during that time, before Bach, you played the piano with three fingers. He revolutionized the music world because he went from three fingers to five fingers. He could play with five fingers. It's kind of mind-blowing, right? But you know, they also tell us that when hockey was around 100 years before, somebody got the bright idea to put a helmet on the goalies. And people used to play hockey. I think it was hockey, or maybe it was football. I think it was hockey. To put a helmet on. So sometimes these little breakthroughs could take generations to come about. But also in the art, something amazing happened. We went from looking at a painting in the Renaissance to actually being brought into the painting. And that was during the Baroque. So the Baroque diagonal, it pulls us in. It invites us into the painting, okay? And so if you want, so if you want to invite somebody into this painting, you use a Baroque. If you want to make them feel that they're welcomed into this image, then you bring them into a Baroque. So let me bring up a whiteboard real quick. I'm going to draw a quick diagram to give you one concept of this. I think it'll be fun for you guys. I'm going to do a new share. I'm going to share my whiteboard. Hopefully this works. Okay. Let me bring the whiteboard up here. Can you guys see a big white screen? Type yes in the comments if you do. All right. This is working perfect, man. This is cool. I should have sat down before. Okay. Let's get a story. The story is a man and a woman sitting on a couch watching some TV. Okay. If I do the drawing, let's say this is the couch. Okay. And here's the man, and here's the woman, and they're sitting on the couch, okay? And they're watching TV. Does that make sense to people? Okay. If you walked in on this scene, these people watching TV, would you feel weird? No. You would feel like, hey, scoot on over. Let me share some of that popcorn and sit on the couch with you. Right? But because it's on a Baroque. But if we take that same scene and we draw it on a Sinister, here's the guy and the girl, and they're sitting on the couch watching TV. You walked in on that scene, you would almost feel like you were walking on an intimate moment between two lovers. Like, you don't feel like you belong there. Like, it's like, it's not inviting you in. Do you guys feel the difference? Do you see the difference? That's the subtlety. Sometimes what happens, we had an artist at the Academy, a brilliant painter. She was a brilliant painter. She is a brilliant painter, she's still alive. She's a brilliant painter out of Australia. I shared this one topic, this one concept with her, and she said, oh my God. See, her ideas are Baroque in nature. They're to invite people in. But she had no idea that all her paintings were designed on sinisters. And so when people are looking at an idea that they should have felt invited into, they were actually at a subterranean level being told not to look at it, because the sinister was telling the people, it was making them feel like, hey, you shouldn't be looking at this. And so that's what I mean by schizophrenic artwork. You have an intent to give, but the design says, no, I'm not going to give. You get me? And there's a conflict. This one little concept blew her mind, and she's like, that's why I'm not selling. People look at my work and say, wow, it's great, but they're not buying it. She couldn't understand why. Bam, this is one of the reasons why. That's why you have to be very, very conscious of your design work. All right, so let me bring back the presentation and let us get into this last design. Again, these are the crosses or the crisscross or the X, if you want to call it, the Baroque and the sinister inside these three boxes. So let's look at this Baroque painting by the brilliant Caravaggio. You like how I say it in my sexy Italian? Caravaggio. Nancy, you said you love this one. If you love this one, by the time I'm done showing you what I'm going to show you, you're going to break out a ring and marry this puppy. This is called St. Thomas. St. Thomas was, or as we like to call him, Tommy Boy. Tommy Boy was the disciple that didn't believe. He was the doubting Thomas, exactly. You know, I've come to this place in my spirituality where I actually embrace, I'm not an atheist, but I love atheists. And I think every person who wants to develop a very strong faith needs a very good atheist friend. Not one of those asshole atheists, but one of those that are very intelligent, who keep you accountable to your ideas and hold you to the fire. And I've come to this place after 20 years of being with one of my dear friends. And I say, you know, in the dimensions of God, there is a place for the atheist. They may not believe in him, but he created them, and I love them for it. And when I look at the doubting Thomas, I see that reality. Here is a disciple of Christ, and he doubted. And in a weird way, the atheists are almost like closer to God, because what other disciple that we know of, maybe in some religions they preach something different, but what other disciple put their finger inside Jesus? Kind of funny. But it's profound. It was the doubter who actually got to be on the inside of his form, right? I mean, it's an amazing concept when you think about it. And because of that, I embrace the atheists. I love them, and I appreciate the value they bring into my life, because spiritually they've only made me freaking dynamite, okay? So let's take a look at this painting. The moral of that story is don't hate your neighborhood atheists. Embrace them, love them. Just don't let them put their fingers inside you. That could be kind of weird and gross. But if we look at this image, first of all, let's take a look at the line work, okay? And see what's happening, because we're being sucked into this hole. We're being sucked into this moment. And here is how it works. Notice that the arms and the lighting and the placement of Jesus' face and the placement of his garb, his clothing, of the bent nature of his hand, the fingers of Thomas, look at the alignment of the knuckles of Jesus in his hand. All of these little things are not hands and arms and clothes. They're alignments, they're marks, they're edges. They create line that moves us. Those lines capture the energy that was void in that image before one mark was made. Someone had to make a decision what the intent of this piece was. What lines out of the infinite amount of lines, which lines will I use to convey this concept? You feel it. It sucks you in. Bam, do you see it? Just look at every part of this image. It all leads back to the whole. Bam. Right? I had another comment come in my head, but I will not let that one fly out of my mouth. I'll have some level of restraint. Now, we look at the mother rectangle, and we see what we call the major sinister. The major sinister is the big, big sinister in the piece. There is no other sinister that big. Every other sinister supports this one. Okay? Does that make sense, guys? It's the biggest because it goes to the furthest two points in the image. Okay? What did I say earlier? When you follow a sinister, the sinister makes you see what's underneath it, not what's above it. So in this piece, it's not important that we see Jesus and we see the other two guys in the back, probably Peter and someone else, and might be Peter and John. And we don't see Thomas. What's interesting is we see his face a little bit, but his head we don't see, right? It's up above that line. So what is important in this piece are the hands of Jesus guiding the hands of the doubter to come in and see that he's real. That's the sacred part of this piece. The people, the characters in this story are irrelevant because the Baroque painting isn't about the characters in the Bible. It's about you, the character. It was inviting you into this piece. Notice that the hole that Jesus is, has on the side is big enough to stick another finger in. So Thomas is showing you the way, but Caravaggio has designed the way for us to put our own finger in there. So let's move on to another rectangle. This is a square. Remember, our eyes will automatically calculate the distance of the height and the distance of into the width, and it will know, it does the calculations. For example, if you want to try it now, you can try it, or you can try it later. Why don't we try it later? But I'm going to give you an exercise. Take a piece of paper and throw it on a floor. Imagine that you just threw a piece of paper on the floor, okay? Now, in your head, stand and then jump and land on that piece of paper. We all know, unless we don't have legs, that if we did that in real life, if we stood up, threw a piece of paper on the floor, and we jumped from where we were to that piece of paper, how many of you know that you would land on that piece of paper? Say yes in the comment. Would you land on that paper? You're confident that you would. And yet, think about the amount of math. Think about the calculations that have to occur, that the mind has to know the distance without a tape measure, that it has to calculate the distance somehow, that it has to know the amount of effort and force so that you don't jump too far or too or not far enough. It needs to know what muscles to activate, at what point, at which timing. All of these amazing calculations, if we wrote them out, would be like an entire physics class, right? And biology class, and kinetics class, and math class, geometry class, all of this calculation. And yet our mind does it, bam, like that, right? It's the same thing when we're composing art. That's why we have to manage our spaces, because our mind already calculates the reciprocals and the rebated squares in a composition. It does that automatically. And that's why it's prudent to compose with the geometry of the rectangle. And every rectangle has its own, I mean, not its own, but it has a principled geometry, okay? This is what we call the sacred geometry, because it's a given. It is a law that we are going to relate to this geometry, this space, in a certain way. So in this case, he knows that a square is activated because he has a height, and our minds are going to automatically bring in a square width. And look what he does. He plops the finger of Thomas right on that rebated square, right on that square. Brilliant. Brilliant. Did he use the golden ratio in other paintings? He may have used the golden ratio in other paintings, but this is not a golden ratio painting, okay? If you take the square of a golden section rectangle, and if you take the mother rectangle, here, because that's a great question, okay? He's using the principles of the golden section, but this is not a golden section rectangle. So let me explain why real quick before I move on. If you have, I'm going to really butcher this because I can't draw a straight line with this thing. If you have a golden section rectangle, okay, and you come in with a square, okay, here is that square. What's left over, this section here, right, is equal to the daughter rectangle. Remember, if we take the horizontal, the mother rectangle, and we flip it 90 degrees, right, and make it a portrait, we're going to have a rectangle that's exactly the same nature as the main. It's just going to be smaller. So what's going to be equal is the height of the mother rectangle and the height of the daughter rectangle. So this daughter rectangle is exactly perfect to this. That is the golden section rectangle, okay? So where that square comes in, the leftover space is exactly the reciprocal. And then the mother contains the three, okay? Now, look at this rectangle that we're looking at here. That space that's left over is a lot smaller, right? Yep. It's a lot smaller. It's not a golden section rectangle. But he's using the same principles. So we say golden sectionizing your work, okay? Because we want to focus on the principles. The golden section is one of the rectangles that we use, but most people at the academy don't compose with it because it's only good for certain things, okay? But we use the same principles, and we work with seven other rectangles, okay? But it is a beautiful rectangle, but he's not using it in here. So we have... Let me go back here just so that we have our sinister. We have a square, and the square brings us to this crucial point. And now we're going to bring in a reciprocal. And the reciprocal has a dominant Baroque and has a dominant sinister as well. But the dominant Baroque is what's important. Now, why would I say it's important? Well, because... Let me draw on top of this image. Hold on. We have a point here, We have a point there, okay, that's along that line. The nipple comes through that sinister. Right here, the edge of the hole in Jesus' thing comes in. But really, there's nothing else. But when we look at the alignment, let me see if I can find a white color here. Okay. Look at the angle of Jesus' hand on that Baroque. Look at the angle of the garment right here. It mimics the angle of this Baroque. Okay? Look at how all these points converge right where that Baroque comes through. Look at how these alignments converge where that Baroque comes through. Look at the angle of Jesus' chest coming up through here. Look at how Jesus' face comes all the way up, right? His nose, his mouth, his beard, all up on that Baroque. It's all up in that Baroque. and so on. Places of value inside Peter's head up in here. So there's a lot more alignments on that Baroque that tells me that the Baroque is what's more important in this composition than the sinister. Does that make sense? Okay, cool. So that's how we're going to determine which is, if it's a sinister or Baroque, okay? Also, when you get on this side, you can just look at the thrust, okay? The general movement of the lines like we talked about in the earlier pieces. It's moving us from the bottom left-hand corner to the top right. There's really nothing that's moving us on that top right-hand corner down, okay? So that's another way of determining that. So when we bring all three of these together, the story tells us that this part is sacred. The mother rectangle tells us this part is sacred. The rebated square, the square comes in and says, this is the significant area. And when we're in here, this space is designed on a Baroque. It's inviting us in. So what it's saying is, within this sacred space, there is something that's happening that's significant, and you're invited into to participate into it. Do you see that? That's the genius of how he divided this space to support the story. And look at the hole is designed. The left-hand side of the hole is designed on this Baroque, and the right-hand side of the hole is designed on the rebated square, on the square. Brilliantly. If he did this arbitrarily without designing it, without composing, without architecting and engineering this masterpiece, this is why it's a masterpiece. It's not because he had a funny feeling he wanted to paint a picture, a pretty picture. He wanted to engineer an experience. And he did it. This is why we study him today. This is why we honor him today. Because he did it. There were a lot of other painters during his time, but I don't know who they were. He did it. Sure, he used chiaroscuro or whatever they call it with the strong contrast of lights and things. He was a master of that. Yes, he did do that. But he was a draftsman first, just like Degas said. Got me? Why was Picasso brilliant? Because when he was 14 years old, he was a draftsman first. Got me? Then he became a painter. An artiste. Let me just say it one more time because I kind of like the way it sounded. Got me? It is the painting, Jay. It is the painting. The art is in the design. Without the design, we don't have the language. I'll tell you my theory. I can't prove it because I'm not, 200 years old yet. About 100 years ago, we had a very big shift in education. we had a very big shift in our culture. The people that were in charge of educating wanted to pull us away from religion. And I don't mind the religion, but away from, Kenyon Cox said it this way, and he wrote about 100 years ago, he said, artists are not spending time in nature. Meaning, they're not spending time with the universe, with this thing called God, with this thing called nature, this thing called life. They're not appreciating the order and the design. He called it the classic spirit. And when we don't, we're taught something else. And what happened around 100 years ago was a movement where we were pulling away from believing that there was order to the universe to this concept of chaos. We were evolving, okay? Things were not divinely planned and ordered. They were happenstance. They were by choice. They were by, not choice, they were by chance, okay? And I only bring that up because artists create that way now. Think about that. Artists create from chaos. Before they created, they composed from order. It's a shift. And what's interesting about Darwin, you know, in his writings, from my understanding, he only mentioned this idea of this survival of the fittest, this idea of like how things evolve like that from you know, one killing another or beating another and then the stronger exists or whatever. He only mentioned it, I think it was like, you know, very few times. But what he talked about the most was what we would call love, right? This idea that everything worked in harmony with itself, with nature. Like, you know, the plants did this and that did this. There was a relationship in this cosmos. We don't really talk about that part of his writing. That's what we do as composers. We're coming back to this, we're designing cosmos, we're designing a universe. This is geometry that I'm showing you. And what does geometry mean? I used to always think it was about math until I looked at the etymology of the word, and it means the measurement of Earth. What? The measurement of Earth? That's what it, then it made sense to me. As artists, we are amazing because we have this ability not to only stand in the invisible, but to commune with it, to participate with it, to see it, to have certainty in it. And we have this ability to pull in it and some way to pull out of it and manifest it in the earth. So this idea of spending time in this invisibility and making it visible, that's what the nature of the artist is. And so we use geometry so that we can learn how to take that which is intangible and begin to construct it, begin to earth it. We take the heavens and we make it into the earth, right? We do it, we put order to it, we put design to it. If you notice, you know, I come from a Christian background, and like, you know, the majority of Americans do. But what I found fascinating is that most of the patriarchs of the Bible were artists. You had Abraham, who carved, you know, his father was a sculptor, basically. Jesus was a carpenter. He built furniture and things like that. Moses was a carpenter. He built furniture and things like that. He's a furniture designer. These guys were architects. Joseph was an architect. I mean, you look at all of these. David was a musician. He could cut your head off with a sword with one hand and play a beautiful song on the other. We call him a warrior poet. There's a beautifulness in that. It's very samurai, right? To be able to kill you with one hand and give you life with another. It's a beautiful thing that to know that in one person, you have the ability to not only speak life and death, but you have that ability, that nature, to this is one reason why I like cowboys. You know, cowboys are very romantic, you know, in a sense. You know, they play their little songs of men, and yet they carry a gun, not only to have that dunamis power available if necessary, but also to be conscious of the fact that their life could be taken too, right? But anyways, I don't want to go off on a tangent, but it's the combination of these things, right? As artists, we have this cool combination where we can spend all this time in this ethereal, esoteric reality, and we bring it back. And those who like to engineer, who like to architect, we tend often to become more metaphysical in our spirituality, right? So we're not all about form, religion, but we're also not all about, you know, overly woo-woo stuff either. But there's this, we want to find this beautiful bridge between the two because we appreciate both. And when you become a composer, what's beautiful is, and I know you guys experience this today, you're beginning to see art both as a right brain and a left brain exercise. So the composer, when they're making artwork, they're engaged fully. Their brain is fully engaged. It's not drawing with the right side of the brain. Somebody should hit somebody with that book, you know? There is a part where you have to be free and boundless in your ideas. Then when it comes to actually articulating them visually, now you have to become a little more left brain and engineer these things. But you have to be both, because one is the message, the other one is how we articulate it, right? So there are a lot of artists out there who have a great message, they don't know how to articulate it. And there's a lot of artists out there who have pretty badass skills, but what they're saying is like, eh? Yeah, it's weak, it's soulless, they're not saying anything. I always like to say it's like a beautiful woman. You take her out to eat and then she opens her mouth and just drools on her steak. She doesn't have anything to say, right? But if you have, you know, a beautiful woman sitting across the table from you or next to you, which is better, and she has a profound mind, now you have like heaven, you know? Well, at least from a man's perspective, because we're visual creatures. So you have beauty and brains. That's divine, right? So, you know, even the Greeks talked about it this way. They talked about eros and psyche, you know, psyche, meaning the mind, eros, passion, right? And how passion, we all have this passion for our art. And passion, eros, fell in love. I guess he hit himself with an arrow. He's also known as Cupid. And he saw Psyche, who was a human, right? And so he pursued Psyche. Finally, Psyche, over time, gave in to Eros and fell in love with him too, okay? But they wanted to get married, but they weren't allowed because gods could not marry humans. So they went to this other god, I forget her name, goddess, and she turned Psyche into a demigod. So she was both godlike and she was both human-like, right? And because she was a demigod now passion could get passionate with her, let's just say. And they did. They got married in this story. They had a baby, and the baby's name was Delight, okay? And so the reason why I love this story is because before we knew knowledge, we had passion to create. We wanted to create artwork. We wanted to make it amazing, right? And now you need knowledge, but not just knowledge. You pursue knowledge. But at some point, before the passion can really merge with the knowledge, that knowledge needs to elevate. It needs to embrace the divine nature. It needs to become wisdom. And when the passion and the wisdom come together, now you have magic. You have delight. Okay? This is where it happens. Actually, even the word Yahweh, you know, that we call God, it's not a name. It's actually a concept. You know, if you break it down into the four letters, it means the source, the energy, the passion, the invisible nature, right? It merges with the physical. you know, so it's the ya merges with the way. And then and then there's a spark that happens. That's the fourth part of the tritrinogram. And then it creates a new way, a new human, a new being, a new creature. This is the concept of this thing we call God. It's the equation of life. And that's what we're doing here as composers. We're thinking, we're being in this spirit, inspired, in spirit, in energy, in passion. We're using our wisdom, our knowledge, our geometry, our use of space, our use of materials. We're combining that. We're fusing our passion with it, and we're birthing something new. We're birthing an amazing, a new creation. We're a creation. It's a creation, right? But it's a merging of that passion, that spirit, and now that thing is infused in that thing. Do you get what I'm saying? You know, this is why years and years ago, the shamans were the artists. They were also the priests. They were the doctors. You know, we start separating those things. Back in the Renaissance days, if you wanted to find the artist, they were not in a painter's guild. They were in the medical guild, because the painters and the doctors had to know anatomy. They had to know geometry. They know how botany. They needed to know chemistry. You wanted a blue in your painting, you had to go climb a damn mountain and dig it out of the ground and go through a chemical process. You didn't just run down to your local art store and buy it in a tube, right? So you needed to know these sciences. You needed to know this knowledge. And then you merge that. You make love to that thing. That's the eros. It makes love to that knowledge. This is why Picasso said, because of the art and the science, I mean, the intelligence. Picasso also said, you know, there's a part when you're making art that becomes passion. He says, you know, when you make love to a woman, you don't pull out your measurement tools and start measuring her body, you know? Although that could be kind of cool too. But anyways, but there is a point in which the passion needs a channel, it needs a vehicle. This is the passion is the muse. We're communing with the muse. If we're only looking at the model, we're just tracing form, we're copying, okay? But when we begin to compose, now we're being inspired by what we see. We're communing, we're dancing, we're making love to it, right? And bop, 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 bam, 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 bam. Now we have a beautiful composition, okay? So this is what composers do. We're not making refrigerator art. We're not making pretty pictures. We're communicating badass concepts, deep concepts. And I know you wouldn't be on this call, on this webinar, if you weren't serious about your artwork, if you weren't serious about what you wanted to communicate. So if you want to take it to the next level, it's out there. There's a place for you. Again, we're telling stories. We're using line, space, and value. We can also get into temperatures and colors, you know, and look at the science of those things, merge them with our passion to communicate something that actually triggers and resonates with our viewers. Let me show you a couple artists at the Academy. Mind if I take a little time and share some of these people with you? This is one of our artists, Martin. Go, please do. Okay. Martin is an emerging artist. And this is our composition process. You start with an idea. We give you a thrust map. Now, everybody who showed up today, you're going to get what we call our thrust map. That is my thank you for spending time and listening to my funny stories and my, you know, whatever, sound effects. And also being receptive to this information, okay? So as a thank you, you're going to get our thrust map. Now, our thrust map is a very, 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 very simple concept, but it is absolutely profound. And if you spend 10 minutes with it, it will change the way you compose art for the rest of your life. It also will allow you, just using the thrust map, you go into a museum and you look for the thrust map and ask these five questions, it will unlock paintings for you. It will unlock it, you know, deeply. Once you get into the deeper stuff, then you can even get deeper with it, okay? But this will be your basic alphabet that will begin to, that will allow you to begin to read paintings as well as make them, okay? So he starts with a sketch, he goes through a thus map, then we go through line, okay? He takes his sketch, that the sketch, the idea is that part of the process where he's just allowing himself to flow, just to get an idea on paper, okay? Then he'll bring in the geometry. You can see that in the top right-hand corner. This is two parts of the process. It's the spacing, and it's also the line work. He merged it into the same process. Then we go and we develop a value plan. So we have a system so that you can control every value without mixing and wasting paint. Okay, if you're a painter, it sucks when you sit there and you overmix your paints and the thing isn't working, you can't figure out why it's not working. Now you will know why. You will know why before you ever mix 1 ounce of paint, if this painting, if this composition is going to work or not. So this is all pencil and paper and tracing paper. And if you have a light table, that really helps too. Okay? So we bring it through the concept, the story, we put a thrust map on it, we bring it through a line strategy, a spacing strategy, a value strategy, and then you execute your value study, okay? And so Martin's out of California. We call him Don Neutrum because he's advancing extremely well. He's been with us for maybe about 6 months. These paintings, this was actually done probably about 2-3 months ago, and he's composing a series of 5 of these dancers, and this was the first one he did, and the other 4 are just brilliant. So this is his final execution of it. Gorgeous. I love that woman. But anyways, so just amazing, amazing. So here's Julie. Julie is a professional artist, okay? She came up with this brilliant concept of having life and death, like decomposing and recomposing. She used the same exact, actually this grid here I created for her, and then Martin took it and composed his work from it as well. Her image is right here, and then she brings the line work and she plans out every value. Look how deep she goes. She ain't playing no games. Interesting enough, notice that it's on a Baroque angle. She's the painter who did everything on a sinister. So she wanted to make sure that this thing was done on a Baroque. Look at the intelligence of her art. And here is, I have to replace this painting. This painting is actually the stage right before it was finished. These yellows here are a lot more lower tone. They're not as bright, they're not as dark, okay? The reason why is because this was the point of contrast, and so she brought that forward and put the others back. But you can see her skill level in painting, but now she's bringing design into it. What's beautiful is she had a show and she posted this show among her old work, and she had this one and people came in and said, there's something different about this piece. There's like geometry or something to it, right? Exactly, exactly. So she's a professional artist. We saw an emerging artist, we saw a professional artist. Here's another artist, let me show you. And the reason why I show you this one is because she's so adorable and so beautiful and she's so cute and she's my first child. This is Sophia. Sophia, I named her when she was 12, and her name means wisdom. So she is the mind of my house. And each of my children have a name because one of the quotes at the academy is, as in art, so in life. And the fact that we compose our art, we also compose our life. So this top picture here is her around 3 years old working on grid work. So it's bullshit when we look at little kids and say, oh, they don't need to do anything. They'll give them some paint and let them move their fingers around in it, okay? The systems that we've created at the academy, she's using at 8 years old. She's done her sketching. She's gritting it out, doing her line work. You see the top of this eye? And why does this end here? It doesn't go up further. Why? Because she wanted her dominant horizontal to go through the eyeball. She wanted her dominant vertical to go through the eyeball. She wanted her dominant diagonal to go through the eyeball. This is her thrust map. And then she's put 4 hours into this sketch. About 5 hours at this time, right? Now she needed to go through the value stage. And she's like, Daddy, can we do the values? 5 hours in, she's still excited. An 8-year-old excited 5 hours into designing something. Why? Because it's stimulating her right brain, her creativity, and her left brain, her thinking. She's feeling alive. She's seeing magic happen. So I don't give a crap if you're 8 years old or 80 years old. It works. Bill Jordan, today, I posted on the Facebook, was the day that he hung his first show, or his first major show. And I worked with Bill for 3 months. We composed out 13 paintings. He was my first real student at the Academy a little over a year ago. And he had a show up in New York. And Bill is in his 70s, or he's about ready to turn 70, somewhere around there. And he painted walls and did wallpaper his whole life. That was his father's business, and then he took that, he did the same kind of work. And when he retired, he said, I always wanted to be a painter. I don't have time to go to all these art classes, and I don't have time to waste. I need something that's going to give me the biggest ROI on my money. And so he decided that composition was the way to go. If he could improve his compositions, he could produce work that he could be proud of before he dies. And that's what he did. And I'll tell you, man, when I watched Bill go through that process, I cried a couple times because I knew if this man didn't have this information, the wealth of knowledge in him, he didn't have the language to speak it. And his artwork, he was using gold paint and all kinds of gimmicks to make it significant. Now that he's a composer, he eliminates all that bullshit and he gets down to business and he's communicating profound ideas. His artwork raises the consciousness of who we are. His artwork's changed my life. When I deal with people, I think about his 13 states of consciousness. Those were the paintings that he created. And I think about the relationships and the time that we spent, the decisions that he made, the reason why he chose the lines he's made, because he was trying to communicate these ideas. And they affect the way that I deal with people. Profound work. So he had his show. And now I'm going to tell you the goal of the Academy. Our goal by the end of this year is to get 80 core people. We're calling them our core 80. We want to get a core of 80 people. And when 2017 comes, we're locking the door to the Academy and we're spending 1 year invested into the people of the Academy so that by the year 2018 comes, we have 80 powerful beep, 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 beep composers that are coming out of the Academy. And then we'll go into our other phase, which we'll call the Center 300. But right now we're looking for the core 80. And while we're just focusing on those 80 people for the next year, at the same time, because I have a gallery, we are then also reaching out and cultivating collectors and investors so that they understand the value of composition. And so really we're creating a marketplace, people who want to collect really well composed artwork, as well as people who can compose it. And so that's what we're doing here. And if you guys want to be a part of that, let me know. We'll get you set up and get you rocking and rolling. So this is Sophie, my beautiful Sophie. My son is five of six now, I guess now. Last month they all had a birthday. So he's starting to draw and getting into this stuff as well. It's really, really cool. So That's the end of the lecture. Do you guys mind if I share a little bit with you about the Academy, and if you're interested in the Academy, what that entails, the costs, how it runs, and also how we can move forward. Okay, so the first thing I want to do is, before we kind of have like an application process, okay? Because we just don't want anybody, even if they can write a check, to be into the Academy. We are very serious about composition. Now listen, you know, you saw my personality. We have a lot of fun. We have a lot of fun, but we are serious about composition because you can see why it requires serious people, okay? And so if you're interested in an art assessment, usually it'll take about an hour, okay? I'll take a look at your artwork. I'll share with you what's your strengths. There's about five areas that we focus on in composing. Most artists are really strong in about two of them, but they're weak in the other three. And so we can look at that and say, you know, you just have this natural ability to kind of place things properly. And see, what happens is most artists intuitively are doing the right things, okay? But what we do is we take the intuitive artists and we make them intentional. And the way I like to illustrate that concept is this. Imagine doing a puzzle, and all the pieces, for the most part, are in the right place, but they're not locked in. Without them being locked in, the image it creates is off. All right, it's not as Martin calls it, pixel perfect pictures. Right, it's not pixel perfect. It's not the way it's intended. Okay, so when we actually are able to execute what we intended, now we become intentional artists, not just intuitive artists. And like I said, in the story place, in the stage where we're developing our story in the beginning, that's where you become intuitive, and you need that nature, that's a secret power. You need that. But then once you have that, now we have to become intentional, okay? And so if you want to spend an hour with me, just one-on-one, us on the phone, we can use Skype or Zoom, we can look at your artwork, I can answer some questions you might have, text me at 610-927-5791, art assessment, and then I'll go ahead and set up a time with you. To do that, okay? Cool beans. Or use Facebook message. That'll work perfect. Thank you, Nancy. All right, so let me share the cost with you of the Academy. There's two parts to the Academy. There's our training, okay? And then there's our weekly meetups. The weekly meetups are amazing because that's where we get together as a group, and we keep the group small so that way there's no one who hides. You know, you're not going to be part of a group and then like, oh, I'm just going to hide in the background. It's a safe place, okay? And you bring your work and people will critique it. Now, we don't do bullshit critiques because we care about composition and we care about you. So we're not going to blow smoke up your feet or up your skirt like Maxville Parrish did in Ecstasy. We're going to get serious about your work. Now, we're not going to talk about, you know, how does this feel? You know, we're not going to do those kind of critiques. We're going to talk about your composition. What was your intent? Did you succeed with your line strategy? Did your spacing strategy work? Did your value strategy, is it coming, are you pulling it off? Is your temperature strategy working? Is your color strategy working? We're going to walk you through that process, and you're going to have a team of people who know the language, who know the experience, who give a shit about this, who care about this, who care about you, and they're going to be part of this journey as you go through this. It is extremely amazing. It is where the growth happens. So when you go to college, they often say, you know, the classes where you're getting instructed in, you learn about 25% in your classes. The 75% of your learning happens through the relationships that you make. That's what the weekly meetups are. And so you have a group, and you'll meet with that group weekly. And so about 2 to 3 times a month, you'll have an opportunity to show your work, but you'll always have an opportunity to give feedback as well, okay? In the academy, in the meetup, we do two things prior to that. Before we get into the critiquing, we do what we call a vision casting and a quote master. So we have a quote master and a vision caster each week. The vision caster basically, in their own words, shares with the group what composition means to them, how has it changed their life, or how does the academy, what does the academy mean to them? How does it change their life? How are they changing their thinking? Okay. And the academy is really the relationships that are going on between the people. Okay. The quote master is what we did in the beginning of this. Every week, somebody is assigned to go out and find a quote for that week. And it deals with composition or design or storytelling. Okay. That way we can keep in the mind of these old greats, these masters. And that's basically the meetup. We get in, we critique, and then it's over. It usually lasts about 1 hour to 2 hours, depending on, you know, what happens. But it's a brilliant experience. The second part is the people who come into that weekly meetup, they have to know the common language, okay? So we have a training that you have to go through. And that's going to walk you through 3 to 5 projects, okay? And you're going to develop your story. You're going to develop your line strategies, your values, and your spacing strategies. And you're going to compose all 5 exactly at the same time. Now, the reason why I do that, that I make you guys do that, is because if you only worked on one image, all of this new experience is going to get lost. But let's say, you know, you're working on line and there's different strategies for line and you have 5 images, right? And you're composing those 5 images and you're only consumed with the line strategies of this one and that one and this one and that one. What happens is the power of line and thrust becomes very, very clear, very, very fast because you're saturated, you're baptized in this knowledge, right? And you're not, it's not getting washed away by all of the other stuff because you're doing it over and over on these 3 to 5 pieces, okay? Then you move to the next stage, which is the spacing. And again, you're going to understand our grids. You're going to understand spacing strategies. You're going to get it. Now, you're not going to become a master at it. That's going to take a little time, okay? But you're going to get it. You're going to be able to come to the meetup and contribute. When people critique your work, you're going to understand what people are talking about, okay? So the training is absolutely important. It gives you the instruction and the language, and the meetups give you the place, a safe place to practice it, okay? And get feedback on it. So that's our system. Here, I'm going to share the cost with you on that, okay? Now, we ain't cheap. We're not a $10 art lesson. You can see why. One reason why we're not cheap is because this isn't about us. This is about you. And it is absolutely important that you demand from yourself that you're going to get this information, that you're going to apply this information, okay? And the way one way we do that is we raise the price a little bit, because if you don't pay for it, you don't care about it. And so if you pay it, you're going to freaking show up and get it. You got me? I can give you the information for free, and I can give it to someone who pays, and the person who pays is going to get it because it means more to them. Okay? Same information, but it means more to that person. That's why we charge, and we don't charge little amounts for what we do. Does that make sense? Now, so we charge $100 a month for the weekly meetups. That's $25 a week for your meetups. $1,500 for the coaching. At this point, anyone who signs up is going to be coached by me, okay? We're still small enough to do that, which is beautiful. That's why we're calling the Core 80, okay? So you're at an amazing time in this process. Now, because you showed up on this webinar, I'm going to give you guys a little bit of a discount, okay? I'm going to cut you a break. We're going to drop that price from $100 to $60 a month. And so that you, we're going to even lower the risk a little bit. Your first month will be $30. If it's not for you at the end of the month, just let us know. We'll cut the credit card off. You move on. All right. So you have a $30 risk in there. Okay. And then you won't have the meetups. And if you sign up for the meetups, which is, if you sign up for the meetups on this deal, the training we will cut to $950. Okay. We will cut down to $950. If you need, I'm willing to break that price up into two payments if you need. Okay, we'll do one payment today, another payment in 30 days. We'll do, I guess it's 425 or 475, I mean, right? So we'll do, if you're going to break it up, I think we charge $499, just whatever. Okay, so that's what that'll be. But because you came on this meetup, it's $950 for the training, and $60 a month in the first month is $30. If you want this and you're saying, oh man, I really, really want this, but I don't have, you know, $1,000 right now to get started, or $550 to get started, that's okay. Okay. There is a way to finance it. And one strategy to do it is if you go to PayPal and you have a PayPal account and you sign up, there's a thing called PayPal credit. Okay. If you sign up and you're approved, they give you $1,000 to spend. And if you use it, they give you 6 months. If you use more than $100, they give you 6 months to pay that off without adding any interest to it. Okay. So you can go to PayPal and sign up. And okay, cool beans. Awesome, Nancy. And we'll get you started. So the first thing I want to do is send you, there's three things we want to do. One, text me if you want the assist, I'm going to go back to the phone number so you have it. Text Black Dog to 610-927-5791, or if you're on my Facebook, text, message me, Black Dog, okay? That way we'll get you set up with an assessment. You should already have an email sent to you while we were at this meetup. Check your email, and there's a link in there also. If you click it, it should say art assessment. You click that, you can actually just go and schedule a time with me for an assessment. I actually have some. I have my schedule clear today, so if you want an assessment today, get on there and sign up, okay? And sign up. For that, so you can schedule that time, and I will email you guys a link where you can go ahead and sign up for the training as well as the meetup. All right. Any questions? Is there anything I can answer for you guys, either related to composition or the academy or the pricing, anything? Okay, so why don't we talk about that, PJ? Look like you have a great plan, so you know, we can go ahead and get started on that. I'm gonna go ahead and email you guys also. Actually, let me do that right here. I'm gonna type a link here. Start here. DonVictorNC. com. Okay, I'm going to type a link for you guys. Okay, let me just verify that's the link. Okay, great, perfect. If you go there to start here. DonVictorNC.com, it will bring you to a sign up page. Sign up, and that will be the video lesson for the thrust map. Okay? Yes, all meetings are online. Helen, are you live in Reading? Yeah, let me see here. If you're local, I meet at 4 o'clock on Tuesdays here over at the Lewis Long Gallery at GAPS. Michelle and Charlene come in. If you're local, Helen, come on in, okay? Everybody's gonna be jealous because you're going to, Reinhold, yeah, I know who that is. I used to live up in Wintersville. You can come on in on a Tuesday at 4 o'clock, and I teach here at the gallery. So Michelle will be here, Charlene, you probably know Charlene as well. So absolutely, come on down, the price is right, especially today. Cool. So click start here, .domvictormc.com. That will take you to the thrust map page, right? So you log in and that will give you the videos and what I want you to do is, when you sign up for the meetups, your first meetup that you come to, which would probably be this Sunday or Tuesday or Thursday, these are the days that I do this, I want you to have your thrust map with you, okay? It's a very simple thing. Bottom line is learn those five thrusts. Find an old painting or an old drawing, or if you want to create a new one, you can do that. Lay a piece of tracing paper over top of it and just figure out your thrust map. Okay, and when you come, we'll give you feedback on it. And oftentimes, it's a beautiful thing because when the newbies come in, everybody contributes. And what we often find is that the newbie usually comes in with a different perspective, and everybody grows. Everybody learns. Lewis is on here, man. Lewis came in 2 weeks ago and did his thrust map and blew us away. He was like, what? Even Michelle, who has been painting professionally for 20 years almost, was looking at her paintings. She did these beautiful paintings when she was in Cuba, and she's looking at Lewis's thrust maps and said, oh man, like I could have made my people move like this, like Lewis did in his sketch. And it would have given that like more rhythm and more musicality to my work, right? So here, Lewis, the first day at the Academy, shares his work, and it profoundly impacts someone who's been painting professionally and making a great living for 20 years on it, okay? So that's the beauty of the meetups. PJ, then the first 30 is due by, okay, so if you're gonna start, if you're going to come to the meetup on Sunday, then why don't you just pay the first 30 today and get started, okay? I'll go ahead and send out those links. I'll email you guys. Can you all put in your email address in this chat box just so I have it, so I know everybody who's here, and I can send you the two links for that, the training as well as the meetup, okay? Any other questions, guys, that I can answer, either about composition, the Academy, payment issues, questions? Any question, because I've been at this for 25 years. I'll tell you, the guy who trained me, I was 17 years old. And I actually started learning about this before I met him through some of his students. We used to work at Dorney Park together. And Ryan Rhodes was the one who introduced me to Myron Barbstone. And Ryan's story is pretty cool. Ryan was going to, I'm sorry, somebody has a question. Jay, not from me at this point. Work. Okay. I'm anxious to watch this at home so I can get enough out of it to have questions for how to do it. Sure, it's I feel you, Jay. I'm recording this. I'm going to upload it to Vimeo or YouTube. I'll email you guys the link to it so you can come back and rewatch this presentation, right? Deal? Awesome. So Ryan was going to Kutztown. His parents were paying the bill to go to Kutztown, and he just knew he wasn't getting what he needed. He didn't know what he needed. He just knew it wasn't there. And he ended up finding somebody who told him about this little old man up in Coffee, Pennsylvania. And so he dropped out of Kutztown, took a year off, and studied with Myron for a year. And the portfolio that Ryan developed from being with Myron for that year, he applied to Carnegie Mellon. And off his portfolio, they gave him both an undergraduate and a graduate full scholarship. And this, you know, the students that went to Myron grew because they understood these principles, these concepts of design. And the students that were going, that Myron had that were going off to college, he had a lot of adult students, but the ones that were going from high school to college, we earned over $4 million in scholarships. The schools wanted us. It was a story of Scott Gursky who went to RIT, and basically he went to the drawing class and they're like, dude, we can't teach you anything, but do you mind if we go ahead and use your sketches for our marketing? You know, like, hey, we can't teach it, but can we use that to market our school? And so they made all these beautiful posters. And Myron Barnstone, Jake. The old great Myron Barnstone. Yes, I love Myron. Myron was a father to many of us. And when I was 17, Ryan Rhodes introduced me to him, and we got on a phone call with Myron, and Myron says to me, I'm gonna channel Myron for a minute. Myron says, "Hello, young man." He had a very deep voice when he talks, and he says, "So why do you want to learn this information? What do you want to be?" And I said, "Well, you know, I want to be a comic book artist." And he says, "Comic book artist. What's your favorite comic?" I didn't have any favorite comic. I didn't read them. I just looked at the pictures, right? And he's like, "Uh-huh. Who have you read about comics?" And he starts drilling me with all these questions, and I'm like, "Ah!" And then I say to him, "Well, you know, it's not really comics that I'm interested in. It's the figure," which was the truth. I love the figure. "Okay. What have you read on the figure? Who are your artists that you admire that do great figured work?" I don't know, you know. And he says, "That's what I thought. A typical teenager, only interested in nipples and pubic hair." And I was like, holy shit, what just happened? My whole entire world had a big, you know, he revealed that my world was glass, and he was the one who threw a brick through it. And it was such a beautiful transformational moment in my life. That's why I do what I do. I throw bricks through people's windows. And I do it now with such confidence that I don't need to go run away. I stand there and say, "Yeah, I did that." You know why? Because there's a better window for you. And that's what Myron did for me. Myron was, "I need a brick," exactly. Well, I'm a brick thrower, but I also teach you how to lay them too. So Myron is an amazing, a beautiful man. He shut down his school a couple of years ago, and when I used to sell the videos for him back in the day, he really didn't want anyone to teach this information. But when he shut down his studio, there was a need, and so I stepped forward and I took up that mantle. If you watch Myron's videos, you're going to learn a lot. But what Myron leads out, a lot of people say who know him and know me, they say he was the Freud and I'm the Jung. And what they mean by that is, with the Barnstone videos, you're actually going to learn the traditional approach, okay, to composing solid artwork. If you want, go buy them. They're a good investment. What I do is the approach on teaching it is depression mentality teaching, okay? What I mean by that is very lectury, you know, and it works really well if you're sitting there and you have that one hand-on-hand training. But I developed my course for online people. So the videos are smaller, they're more to the point. I have created tools that streamlines 25 years of know-how. One reason that I've been able to do it is because I took his knowledge and I transferred it into the computer. And as a graphic designer, web designer, things like that, I learned how to compose like this. And the computer would do things in seconds that would take nearly almost an hour or two to do by hand, okay? And so while my contemporaries were laying out grids by hand before they could get into their work, I was doing it in seconds on a computer. And so for 20 years, I got to play in the realm of design. I got to understand things about design and communication and storytelling that, with all due respect, nobody I have found, and I don't only say that, but the other people who are around us say it, who are looking for this information, nobody merges the story, which is the why, with the how and the what, which is the composition. And so if you want to learn the how traditional way, I encourage you to go study Myron's videos. But if you want to learn how to communicate a story, this is where you need to be, okay? And if you're wise, you'll do both. But this is where you need to be, okay? So I'm going to open it up for one last round of questions. Anybody, any questions? If not, I'm going to give you guys a big hug. I'm going to say thank you for showing up. I promise you this. One, your life has changed today. Two, you'll never see art the same way again. And I say that boldly because right above me, I have four statements on my wall. One of them is I'm sent. I know this information, and I intentionally set my life up to take this information and give it to you people, okay? I don't want to die. Let me leave you with one story. Why I do this. Years ago, I had a dream, and I was an old man in Portugal. I was living up in a little shack up on a hill. And not a shack, a cottage. It was a thatched roof cottage, which interestingly enough, my last name is Vargas, and in Spanish and Portuguese, what Vargas means is a cottage on a hill, right? A little thatched roof hut on a slope. So I'm living in a place like Portugal, and I have this black dog, and guess what his name is? Norman, of course. And we walk down to the cafe in the local village. And there's like this beautiful, exactly, there's this beautiful, you know, the harbors there. You can smell the fish, you can smell the salt of the ocean. And I meet up with a couple old buddies. You know, we sit around, we have our coffee, and we're bullshitting about, you know, politics and sex and love and women and art and philosophy and religion and all kinds of cool stuff. And, you know, we waste 3 hours pretending that we're, you know, saving the world or figuring out the problems of the world. And Norman is sitting next to me. And I get up, and Norman gets up, and we walk back up to the cabin. The cottage. And I get into the cottage and I close the door behind me and I begin to paint. And as I'm painting, I have a heart attack. And I'm laying on the ground dying. And my soul leaves my body. I can see me dead as an old man dead on the ground. And then I look over and I see Norman. I see my dog, the black dog. And he's left alone. He's left alone in that cottage. And I think, oh, shit. He's going to die in there. You know, after he eats me, you know, he'll stay alive for a little bit. But then ultimately he'll die. And I felt so sad about that. But I never understood what the dream meant. And until I met Costanza Bioka. Costanza is one of the most beautiful souls I've ever met in my life. She's a little older lady. She used to be a lawyer up in New York, and now she's an amazing painter. She's part of the Samagundi Club. And Costanza and I were talking, and I shared that story with Costanza. Costanza, being at a very different place in life, had a very profound take on that story. And she said, "Victor, the dog is composition. The dog is design. And if you don't let this dog out, it will die with you. It will die in your studios, it will die with you." And when she said that, man, the hair on my back, my arm, it, you know, I became like a little dog. But, you know, it just stood up and I knew she was speaking truth. And that was maybe about a year and a half ago. And since then, I started the Academy of Composition to get this information out. I started the Daily Bark. The reason why we call it the Daily Bark is because it's woof woof, it's a bark, it's a dog, to constantly remind me of why I'm here on earth. That is to get this information out. We started the weekly meetups. So there's a lot of things that have been birthed from that revelation. And that's why I do what I do. I don't need your money, but it's absolutely important that I get your success. You get me? It's absolutely important that you guys get this, that you're able to produce, that you become a freaking superhero for your own families, for your own self, for your own people, your own audience. And not only with the ones that were within your life, but the ones that come after. That's why I do this. And that's the energy of the Academy. We're not playing around, okay? This is power. You know, this is reasons why years and years ago, this kind of information were kept locked up in secret societies. This is why people literally were killed for taking this information and trying to get it out years ago. Now, we don't live in that stupidity anymore, okay? But just a generation ago, a lot of art teachers, I mean, art teachers, you go and they don't want to, they're not generous with their knowledge. They're not generous with their energy. Why? Because they come from depression mentality, which is to hoard, to own. This is mine. This ain't mine. Who the fuck am I to say this is mine? What bullshit is that? This stuff existed long before I came around. I've just been blessed to have access to it. And now I give it to you. 500, 300 years ago, in the place where my ancestors came, in a place called Galicia, Spain, my mother's side are the Castros, we came from a place in Galicia. 300 years ago, there was an artist named Don Felipe de Castro. And Don Felipe de Castro was sent to Italy. He was a master sculptor, a master artist. And the king of Spain said to Don Felipe, "Come, we need your help. We want to restore the glory of the Royal Academy of Art. But we don't know what to do." So he came and he said, "The two things you need," he became the director of the Academy. And he, the two things he said you need to focus on is anatomy, right? We have to learn how to draw the figure. And two, geometry. And geometry, as you can see, is composition. And that's what he brought. So here, 300 years later, something in my DNA is attracting me to this information. Something in my mind has allowed me to get this information. And not only get it, but be able to teach it, to make it, to break it down, to get the complexity out of it, and be able to give it to you so that you can be powerful. So I don't look at that I own this information. My goal is to die exhausted. You understand me? To die exhausted. That dog will not be left in that cottage. It must be out. And that's the reason why I do this. So, anyways, I've talked long enough. I thank you for your time. And I hope to see every one of you in the Academy. I will go ahead and send you the information. Scroll up, remember, go to the start here, donvictormc.com, all of you, and get that free training on that thrust map. And those who are coming into the meetup, make sure you have your work done for the first day so that we can give you feedback on it. Okay? Thank you. That's okay, Jay. It's recorded. It's going to take me a few hours to upload it, but I will put it up and I will send it back to you. All right? Thank you. All right. We'll talk soon. Thank you, everybody.